أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
كل نفس ذائقة الموت وإنما توفون أجوركم يوم القيامة فمن زحزح عن النار وأدخل الجنة فقد فاز وما الحياة الدنيا إلا متاع الغرور.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for each and every blessing that He has given us, the blessings that we recognize and the blessings that we do not recognize. For indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has immersed us in His blessings. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and to guide others through us and to protect our faults and to cover our sins. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for iman that is perfect, and for ikhlas that is sincere, and for good deeds that are accepted, and for du'as that are responded to. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal for knowledge that is beneficial, and we ask Allah Azza wa Jal for pure iman and to be amongst the muttaqeen. Alhamdulillah, today we are starting a new series after an entire series that alhamdulillah we managed to do. We're now starting the final series of this multi-series part. If you remember the last talk that I gave in this subject, is that the goal was to really do an entire journey of the end of times, which is the science of the Day of Judgment, which we did last year, and then move on to the barzakh, which is the reality of that intermittent state between death and between the qiyamah. We did 10 series on the barzakh, and then an entire series on the actual Day of Judgment, a very detailed series about the various aspects and the maqams of the Day of Judgment. That was number 3. Then number 4, we have the series about Jahannam and the details of Jahannam. And now the final, this is the 5th series of this entire multi-part series, and our journey has taken us, alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, more than almost a year and a half now, alhamdulillah, of the series. So now we're going to begin the last of our series, and Allah knows how many lessons is going to be. And this series is, of course, in many ways the most important and the most exciting, because in the end of the day, this is our goal. This is the destination. This is why we're doing all that we're doing. Everything revolves around this goal. This is why we are here. This is our ultimate goal. This is the destination. This is our ultimate desire. And that is, of course, Jannah itself, or the paradise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised. And of course, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has described Jannah in so many traditions. And the Quran is full of the descriptions of Jannah in a hadith that is reported in both Bukhari and Muslim. And it is a hadith Qudsi. So this is really the highest of the high, because again, in terms of authenticity, Bukhari and Muslim is the most authentic. In terms of nobility, Hadith Qudsi is the highest category. Hadith Qudsi is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrates from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you have a Hadith Qudsi that is in Bukhari and Muslim, you are really talking about the most blessed and the most precious category of a hadith that is known to man. And one of these Hadith Qudsi is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that أَعْتَدْتُ لِعِبَادِ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ ثُمَّ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ اقْرَأُوا إِنْ شِئْتُمْ فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah Azza wa Jal says in a hadith Qudsi, I have prepared for my righteous servants those blessings that no eye has ever seen and no ear has ever heard about, and in fact even the imaginations of men have never even conceived them. Pause over this hadith here. We are now entering a journey that is going to describe in human words, is going to describe in the speech of men that which no man has seen, that which no ear has heard, and that which no human has even conceived. So realize that our entire series will not even do a fraction of the justice to the reality that is beyond. Our entire series is merely the beginning. This is merely a speech that is meant for us to begin to comprehend. But whatever we comprehend, it is not real. It is not the actual. It is simply some aspect, an infinitesimally small amount of the reality that is beyond even what anyone has heard. And in fact, the descriptions of Jannah, they are only there really to entice us to what we can understand. The reality of Jannah is beyond human description. The reality of what is actually there, words cannot do justice to us. And therefore, that's why the Prophet ﷺ told us that Allah Himself has said that what is really in Jannah is something that no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and in fact, not even the mind has possibly conceived. And then the Prophet ﷺ, after telling us of this, he then says, if you wish to confirm this reality, then look at the Quran itself. And he recited Surah Sajda, verse 17. فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ. No soul has ever realized what has been prepared for them of that which will make them comforted, that which will make them happy. That is because جَزَاء بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. It is a result of all that they used to do. No soul is aware of what has been hidden from them. مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ. It is hidden from the eyes of men. People do not know what it is. People have not seen or conceived it. And yet the Quran is describing it. Now here's the question. How can the Quran describe what Allah Himself is saying that no ear has heard? Think about this, right? وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ لَا أُذُنٍ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has conceived. And yet the Quran is full of descriptions of Jannah. The response to this is, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu said in an authentic athar reported in Al-Bayhaqi, as Ibn Abbas said, لَيْسَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ شَيْءٌ مِمَّا فِي الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا الْأَسْمَاءِ. Memorize this as we go through this entire series. There is nothing in Jannah that is similar to anything on this earth except the name that is being used. The name. So when Allah says Jannah, we understand the Jannah of this dunya. When Allah says an apple, when Allah says there's going to be dates in it, when Allah says there's going to be rivers, تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ, when Allah says palaces, قُصُور, when Allah says chambers, غُرَف, we understand these words. These words, we can imagine them in this world to the most amazing imagination. We can visualize in this world the realities of this world in the most exotic manner. But the actualities of Jannah are beyond mere words. And therefore, words do not do justice. As Ibn Abbas said, the only thing in common with the Jannah of the Akhirah and the Jannah of this world is the word Jannah. The only thing in common with the fawakih, with the fruits of Jannah and the fawakih of this world, with the rumman of Jannah and the rumman of this world, with the qusur of Jannah and the qusur of this world, the only thing in common is the word. The same word is used. Otherwise, the realities of everything in Jannah is beyond human imagination. So whatever description Allah is giving, whatever wording is being used, realize that your imagination is only for this world. And it is not just, it is not doing justice to the exactual, the exact, if you like, existence of what Allah is saying in the Quran. That is only going to be experienced for those who enter it. In fact, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the place that a whip of yours occupies, you know, the whips that you use for the animals, you know, the small little thing that you use, right? That place, a small little place, in those days they would have a small little thing that, you know, you hit the animals if needs to be hit and, you know, beaten to move it faster, whatnot. So he said that small bit that you have, that place of Jannah, that small little amount, it is more precious than all of the blessings of this world, everything in this world. Can you imagine all the wealth of this world, all of the pleasures of this world? Can you imagine the most exotic destinations, all of the treasures of this dunya, everything this world has? And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the place that your whip occupies in Jannah is more precious than the entire creation. Everything in the dunya, it is more precious than that. So then what do you think will be the reality of that abode? And that is why, dear brothers and sisters, as we begin this series, we simply point out these are mere words. The realities are beyond our imagination, and nothing can actually make us understand what is the reality of Jannah until insha'Allah ta'ala we enter Jannah. So all that we have, make this as an incentive for your imagination, because it is only your imagination. And realize the actual incentive, the existence, is beyond anything of our imagination. In fact, everything that we are doing, it is meant for that goal. And this reminds me of a beautiful hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is narrated in Abu Dawud and others, that a Bedouin came to visit the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam observed him praying, and he said that, tell me, what do you say in your salah? What is the du'as that you make in your salah? And so the man said, I simply say the shahada, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, I say the tashahud, attahiyyatu lillah. And then after I finish the tashahud, I ask Allah for Jannah, and I ask Allah to protect me from the fire of hell. And then this innocent Bedouin, he's, you know, new to Islam, he hasn't memorized anything, he simply remarked in his complete innocence, he said, I don't know the murmurings, you know, the Arabic is dandana, that la uhsinu dandanataka wala dandanata mu'adh. I haven't memorized the murmurings, because, you know, when the Prophet would make dua, so he is saying, you can see the whispering, you can hear something, but you cannot hear the reality. So the Bedouin said that, I don't understand your dandana, I haven't memorized your murmurings, or the murmurings of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, who was one of the most famous Sahaba. And the Prophet smiled and said, حَوْلَهَا نُدَنْدِنُ. All of our murmurings, all of our whisperings, all of our du'as are around what you yourself have just said. What was the du'a of the Bedouin? Oh Allah, I ask you for Jannah, and I seek your protection from the fire of hell. This is the ultimate goal. Everything else is secondary. Allah says in the Quran, فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ. Whoever is managed to save from the fire of hell and enters Jannah, that is the person who has won. Everything else is irrelevant. The ultimate goal is Jannah. If we get there, having saved ourselves from Jahannam, then alhamdulillah, everything was worth it. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ smiled and said, حَوْلَهَا نُدَنْدِنَ. Everything is around this. What we are doing, that is all that we are. Making dua about. And of course, our talks today and from this series onwards will be a description of Jannah and what is the reality of Jannah. As we said, as best as we can visualize in reality, the realities are more than what we can visualize. And I will begin today. Today's topic will be about the various names of Jannah that are used in the Quran. What are the names that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses to describe Jannah? And by the way, most of my series will be based upon the famous book of Ibn al-Qayyim, Had al-Arwah ila Bilad al-Afrah, that the guide of the souls to the abode of delight. And this is one of the most comprehensive books ever written in our history of Islam about the blessings of Jannah. It's a beautiful book. And Ibn al-Qayyim has also mentioned poetry, which unfortunately we're going to have to gloss over because it's all in Arabic. And he has compiled many and a lot of detail, the various blessings of Jannah and the various aspects that are related to Jannah. So most of my series will be taken from this book. And of course, I have other references as well. So we're going to begin today talking about the names of Jannah. And of course, the most common name and the prominent name and the one that is used most frequently is the term Jannah itself. In fact, it is used over 120 times in the Quran. The word Jannah is used more than 120 times in the Quran to describe, of course, the abode. And what does the word Jannah mean? The root of Jannah, Jin, Noon, the root. Anytime this root occurs in the Arabic language, it means something that is hidden, something that is concealed. And of course, the asal or the basis is Jim, Noon, Noon, Jannah, and then the last two have been merged with a Shadda, Jannah. So any word in the Arabic language that revolves around the Jim and the Noon, there is something hidden in it. And therefore, for example, the term Jinn is used to describe those entities that Allah created that are beyond our vision. That's the jinn. And the janin is the embryo because it is hidden in the womb of the pregnant lady. And the mujin is the head covering that is put on the when you go to war, you wear that head covering. And the majnoon is the one whose brain is concealed. So he is crazy or he acts crazy. So he's called majnoon because his brain is concealed or his intellect is concealed. And the term junnah is used as a shield. So our Prophet ﷺ said, "As-sawmu junnah," that fasting is a shield or a barrier. So junnah, shield, because when you put that shield, you are covered. Remember, the term jannah means everything that is covered up. Jim nun jannah, not the jim nun ta, which is what we're going to come to. And therefore, jannah with the ta marbuta, which is what we're talking about. Jannah is a garden that is concealed from the eyes of men. Okay, so anything that is beautiful, that is luscious, that is green, and that is covered up, that is called a Jannah. And so, by definition, the term Jannah with the ta marbuta, it means beautiful gardens that are concealed from others. It's your garden. Nobody else will have access to it. It is something for you and only for you. And that is the term Jannah. So this is the most common term in the Quran. And it occurs, as we said, more than 120 times. Of the terms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses to describe this abode is Darussalam. Darussalam. And this is used twice in the Quran. In Surah Yunus verse 25, Allah says, وَاللَّهُ يَدْعُوا إِلَىٰ دَارِ السَّلَامِ. Allah is calling to Dar al-Salam. And in Surah Al-An'am verse 127, Allah says, لَهُمْ دَارُ السَّلَامِ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. They shall have دَارُ السَّلَامِ with their Lord, or in the presence of their Lord. So the دَارُ السَّلَامِ, what is دَارُ السَّلَامِ? دَارُ السَّلَامِ, the word دَار means abode or place that you live in. And of course, سَلَام here means the ultimate place of peace. Salam, there is no harm. Salam, there is no evil. Salam, there is no suffering. Salam, there is no pain. Salam, there is nothing but peace. That's what salam here means. So the abode of salam is the land in which there is never going to be any pain or suffering. No anguish, no grief, no anxiety. Can you imagine? There is not a single day that goes by in our lives except that something is worrying us, something is troubling us. Either there's physical pain or there's mental anguish. It is impossible really that a day goes by except that there's some worry that comes across our mind, because this is not the abode of salam. In Jannah, there is no worry, no grief. And that's why Allah says, لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. They will not fear, nor will they worry. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when the people enter Jannah, they say, أَلْحَمْدُلِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَذْهَبَ عَنَّا الْحَزَنِ. We thank Allah who has removed all anxiety from us. The people in Darus Salam will never be worried about anything. Ultimate peace. That is why it's called Darus Salam. And Darus Salam also implies that the people will be greeted with salam. And this is also in the Quran, that when the people enter Jannah, wherever they go, they will hear salam. And they will see the angels, and the angels will say to them, salamun alaykum bima, salamun alaykum tibtum. That peace be upon you, may you live in peace. Salamun alaykum tibtum. And so the angels will say salam to them. And the people of Jannah will say salam to them. And most importantly, Allah Himself will greet them with salam. Salamun qawlam min Rabbir Rahim. Salamun qawlam min Rabbir Rahim. Salam, it shall be a word from an ever merciful Lord. And so, subhanAllah, we have here the beauty of calling Jannah Darus Salam. Because remember, one of the names of Allah is As-Salam. Allah is As-Salam. Allah Azza wa Jal is the source of peace, and His religion is Islam. And He commanded us to spread salams, and He calls to Darus Salam, and the angels will greet the people of heaven with salam. And so when the people of Islam who spread salams in this earth and followed Islam, when they follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they walk on the abod or the journey of Darus Salam towards Darus Salam, therefore when they enter Darus Salam, As-Salam will greet them with the greetings of salam. And that's what Allah says, Salamun qawlam min Rabbir Rahim. And that's why it is called Darus Salam, the abode of salam. Nobody shall feel anger towards another. Nobody shall feel jealousy. Nobody shall feel hatred. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَاخْتِلَافَ بَيْنَهُمْ وَلَا تَبَاغُضْ. There will be no differing in Jannah. There will be no animosity in Jannah. قُلُوبُهُمْ قَلْبُ رَجُلٍ وَاحِدٍ. Their hearts will be united as if it is one heart. Can you imagine? Every one of us has to deal with grief, with anguish, with talk, and with kalam, and with qila wa qal, with backbiting, with politics. Every one of us has to deal with backstabbing and this and that. That's the reality of this world. When you enter Jannah, nothing, nothing but peace. Nobody is going to backbite you. Nobody is going to cause you any issue. How can it not be called Darus Salam? And so of the names of Jannah is Darus Salam. Of the names of Jannah, we'll put actually three of them now because they're all very similar meanings. Darul Khuld and Darul Qarar and Darul Muqama. We'll mention three of them, in fact, so 3A, 3B, 3C. Darul Khuld and Darul Qarar and Darul Muqama. And all of them imply the same thing, and that is the eternality. That is that they shall live there forever and ever and ever. That's what it means here. That the dar is going to be the dar where people will live permanently. There is not going to be an expulsion. There's not going to be an end. That's what Darul Khuld means. And Darul Qarar, the permanency is going to be there. Darul Muqama, they shall have their iqama. They shall have their residence over there for all of eternity. And of course, these terms are mentioned in the Quran. In Surah Fatir, verse 35, Allah says, that the same verse that I quoted right now, وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَذْهَبَ عَنَّ الْحَزَنِ إِنَّ رَبَّنَا لَغَفُورٌ شَكُورٌ الَّذِي أَحَلَّنَا دَارَ الْمُقَامَةِ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. The people of Jannah will say when they enter Jannah, we thank Allah who has removed all worries from our hearts, and indeed our Lord is forgiving and He is ever thankful for what we have done. He is the one that has permitted for us to live in دَارَ الْمُقَامَةِ from His blessings. دَارَ الْمُقَامَةِ. When they enter Jannah, you know, it's not a temporary move. Every time we move somewhere, we wonder how long are we going to stay here? What is going to be our next place of residence? We do not know. But Jannah is Dar al-Muqama. It is our permanent abode. And that's why Allah calls it Dar al-Muqama. And of course, Dar al-Qarar in Surah Ghafir, verse 39, وَإِنَّ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ دَارُ الْقَرَارِ. That indeed the hereafter, it is the Dar al-Qarar. It is the abode of no coming back, no changing. It will be permanent for all of eternity. So these are terms that the Quran uses to describe the hereafter, and in particular, Jannah is going to be the dar that, excuse me, the dar that there is no coming out of, and it will be a permanent residence. Another common term that the Quran uses is Darul Akhirah. Darul Akhirah, the abode of the hereafter, the abode of the next life. And this occurs around 10 times in the Quran, Darul Akhirah. And generally speaking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses this term to contrast this world with the next world. That it is as if Allah is saying, this world is temporary, this world is not permanent. Why would you substitute the permanent for the next, which is forever and ever? So especially in the context of contrasting the pleasures of this world with the pleasures of the Akhirah, the temporal nature, the temporary nature of this world, and this is the Dar al-Dunya. This is Dunya means close by. Dunya means it's right here. Akhirah, the one that's going to come and that's going to be permanent. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the Akhirah as, look, it's like, imagine you're going on a journey, you take a bus, you take the car, and imagine you stop for a while to freshen up and whatnot, right? This is the Dunya. This is just the stop. and you know that you have to get to the next destination, your final destination, would you, in your temporary destination, you know, construct a big palace when you know you're going to stay there for 10 minutes? You just have to fill up the gas, get some food, you know, freshen up and move on. Would you spend all of your money and wealth in that place? Or would you say, let's just get to the final and then inshallah we can build what we need to build? This is why it's called the Darul Akhirah. It's the final destination. It is where we're going to go. So more than 10 times in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the hereafter and Jannah, He calls it Darul Akhirah. And when speaking of Qarun, for example, the one who was most wealthy of the people of Musa, Allah says, تِلْكَ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةُ نَجْعَلُهَا لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُرِيدُونَ عُلُوًا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فَسَادًا. That in contrast to Qarun, who built his wealth in this world, Allah is saying that the Darul Akhirah is what we should aim for. That's the Akhirah that we should be more interested in, rather than the wealth of this world and what Qarun has done. And Allah said, we shall give it to those who do not live in this world with arrogance. They don't want haughtiness in this world. They don't want to cause any evil in this world. In the context of another verse that mentions Darul Akhirah, in the context of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they asked, you know, there was a point in the seerah when the wealth began to come in, and it is human nature that our mothers, they ask for a higher standard of living. And that's normally, and that's fine, that's absolutely no problem with that. They asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for a higher standard. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not want to live a luxurious life. And so he said to them, which is in the Quran, Surah Al-Ahzab, that Allah gave them a choice, that if you wish this world, then come, I shall give you all that you want, and then I'll let you go. Then Allah says, وَإِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِدْنَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَالدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Notice the context here, that once again, it is this world versus the next world. This is not the permanent, this is not the end destination. So Allah says to the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if you choose Allah and His Messenger and the final abode, then indeed I have prepared for you a reward beyond measure. Once again, the Darul Akhirah. And Allah says in the Quran, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا الْحُسْنَى, that لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا فِي هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَى وَلَدَارُ الْآخِرَةِ خَيْرٌ, that those who do good in this world, they shall have good in this world as well. Then Allah says, but the Darul Akhirah is better than this world. Once again, the contrast, Allah Azza wa Jalla is constantly reminding us by using the term Darul Akhirah, that this dunya is temporary, it's not the final destination. So He keeps on asking us to check ourselves, why are you spending your entire lives on a temporary destination? Why don't you invest for the destination that will be the permanent one, that will come later on, but it will be the final destination? So that's why it is called the Darul Akhirah. Another term that is used in the Quran is Jannatul Ma'wa. Jannatul Ma'wa. And of course, we already explained Jannah, what it means, the meaning of Jannah. And Al Ma'wa here means to find safety and security, to retire to a place of comfort. So the term ma'wa is not always for comfort. Sometimes ma'wa can be used in a somewhat sarcastic manner to imply the opposite of comfort. And Allah uses this in the Quran, the word ma'wa, to describe Jahannam as well, that it's an evil ma'wa. But when Jannah is used, Jannatul Ma'wa, so then now the description becomes positive. Because Jannah and ma'wa put together, they are both positive. And so Jannatul Ma'wa is used a number of times in the Quran. Of them is Surah An-Nazi'at, verse 40, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. That whoever fears the meeting of his Lord and prohibits himself from just following whatever desire he has, then Jannah shall be the ma'wa for him. And ma'wa, as we said, is the place of safety and security and comfort. It is where you're going to, the place of retirement. You're going to go there and you're going to retire. Jannatul ma'wa. And in Surah An-Najm as well, verse 15, Allah says, عِنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى عِنْدَهَا جَنَّةُ الْمَأْوَى. That upon or with the lote tree, which is the highest tree, the highest of the creations of Allah, and there is the Jannatul Ma'wa. And some have said that it is called Jannatul Ma'wa because Jibreel himself and Mikael and the angels, they find Ma'wa, they find refuge in Jannah. So they go to Jannah and it is their Ma'wa, and so it will also be our Ma'wa. Now some have said Jannatul Ma'wa is one of the stations of Jannah and not all of Jannah. And others have said all of Jannah is indeed Jannatul Ma'wa. And the response is that the difference is technical in the sense that sometimes you can say all of Jannah is indeed a Ma'wa, and maybe there's also a level of Jannah called Jannatul Ma'wa. And they derive this from the fact that in Surah An-Najm, Allah Azza wa Jal is specifying that Jannatul Ma'wa is where Sidratul Muntaha comes. And so it is as if the highest level or one of the highest levels is Jannatul Ma'wa. So perhaps we can derive this as well. And some have said, well, Allah uses it here, but in fact it is a description for all of Jannah. And both of these opinions are absolutely valid and they in fact overlap with one another. There's no contradiction between the two of them. Another term that has been used in the Quran is Jannatu Adn. Jannatu Adn. And this term, Jannatu Adn, it has occurred more than 10 times in the Quran, or 10 times in the Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Jannah with the term Adn. And the term Adn, I've already explained this in a previous lecture, but no problem going over this again, that the term Adn, the famous linguist Raghib al-Asfahani, he says that Adn means to remain and to be firm, istaqarra. Ibn Manzur, the famous scholar of the Arabic language in his monumental work, Lisan al-Arab, he says that Adn means to remain at a place, and that is why treasure that is found, that has been remained buried for a long time, that it is called ma'dan, because it's buried over there, it remains in the ground. And of course, the term Adn is known to all English speakers because it occurs in other scriptures as well. The biblical scriptures mention the Garden of Eden, the same Adn. The book of Genesis and Ezekiel, they say the gardens of Eden. And we find it in earlier languages as well, the Akkadian language, Edenu, for the Sumerian has Eden, which means plains or steppe, and Aramaic as well has fruitful and well-watered. Adn here in the ancient Aramaic, it means fruitful and well-watered. So all of these indicate that the term Adn goes back to previous revelations as well, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word Adn in other revelations, and He has also used it in this revelation as well, Jannatu Adn. And it occurs 10 times in the Quran. Once in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses a very interesting term, very interesting, and that is Dar al-Hayawan. Dar al-Hayawan, the abode of Hayawan. Now, when you're basically learning Arabic, when you're just beginning to learn Arabic, you will think Hayawan means animal. In fact, many Arabs will also not understand this. Say, what is Dar al-Hayawan? It means the abode of animals. Because animals are called Hayawan. That's true, that one of the meanings of Hayawan is animals. The word in English animal is synonymous with the Arabic Hayawan. That when you go to the zoo, it is called Hadiqatul Hayawanat. It is the garden of animals, or the zoo here. So why is Jannah called Darul Hayawan? And by the way, where does this occur? In Surah Al-Ankabut, verse 64, that Allah says in the Quran, وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانِ, that the abode of the hereafter, it is the Hayawan, it is Darul Hayawan. Why is Jannah called Hayawan? And it is, of course, the same term that is used as animals. You see, the term Hayawan comes from the Arabic Hayat. And Hayat means life. Hayat means to live. And Jannah is called Darul Hayawan because that is where the real life occurs. What we are living now, it is not the full life. It is a partial life. We eat, we drink, we sleep, we shall die. That's not the ultimate life. In Jannah, we do not need to eat and drink. It's eating and drinking for pleasure. In Jannah, we do not sleep, as we're going to come to. In Jannah, there is no death. That is the ultimate life. We shall be awake in Jannah. The full life living will be in Jannah. So, dear brothers and sisters, this world is not the world of life. It is a world that has partial life, not full life. And that's why the term Hayawan, the construct that it is done, that means the ultimate life, the full life. Now, animals are called Hayawanat because they have life. That's just another term. But that's not the meaning over here. When Allah says Jannah is the Darul Hayawan, right? What He means here is that the life of Jannah is the ultimate life, the essence of life, a life like no other life. That is the real life. That's why it's called Darul Hayawan. And so Jannah is the ultimate life that we need to look forward to. Therefore, what we are living now, we haven't really tasted the sweetness of life. That will be in the next life. And that's why Allah calls it the abode of real life. Another term that is used to describe Jannah is the term Firdaus, the term Firdaus. And this is a very interesting term because, again, it goes back to other languages, other cognates. We call it, the term is cognate, and a cognate is a root or a basis that trickles down to multiple languages. If you know how languages work, and this is something that the Quran also indicates indirectly, that all languages are related to one another. In fact, all languages are basically part of a larger tree. Every single language in the world is related to every other language. We can trace it back. And as society split up and as people go into different cultures, so languages form, they break away. And multiple languages go back to the same, you know, proto-languages, if you like. And then those proto-languages go back to another basic language that we do not know anymore. But it is, of course, the language of our father Adam and Hawa, alayhim as-salam, our father and mother Adam and Hawa. So the point is that you find the same terms in the Quran that you might find in other languages, and that's because all languages are related. And very simple point here, the term Firdaus, it sounds very much like the English term paradise. Firdaus, paradise. The fa and the pa are very easy to interchange between languages, as you should be aware that some languages don't have the pa, the pa sound. Arabic does not have pa. And the term Firdaus and the English paradise, the reason why they are so similar is because they are really the same word. Or we should say their ancestor was the same word, and then it splits up into many different words. So this term Firdaus, some of the early scholars pointed this out, that the famous early grammarian is Zajjaj. He says that Firdaus is not Arabi, it is in fact Roman, Rumi, which means Latin. And it means bustan or garden. Of course, Zajjaj, writing in his time frame, he could not have known any better than this. Obviously, we excuse him for this. Obviously, Latin is not the origin of this. Latin does have paradisus, from which we get paradise, and we also get Firdaus. But in fact, it goes even beyond this. The Greek has paradiosis, and the old English is paradise. And in fact, it goes back to ancient ancient Iranian called Avistan, that paradiesa, and of course paradiesa, paira means to surround, and dieza or deiza is a wall. So again, the term Firdaus is literally like the term Jannah, but in a different cognate or a different language, that a surrounding wall, something is hidden by a wall. That's what paira means round, and dieza means the wall. But of course, we're not interested in the cognate, because when Allah uses it in the Quran, it takes on the Quranic meaning. Whatever the cognate was and whatever was found in other languages, that's of interest to linguists. We can find other benefits from it, but we are interested in how the Quran uses it. And the Quran, of course, uses it to describe Jannah, and the Hadith tells us that it is the highest levels of Jannah. Now, the term Firdaus occurs twice in the Quran, twice and only twice. It occurs twice in the Quran. In Surah Al-Mu'minun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a long list of characteristics of the believers. And then Allah says, whoever is able to do that, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْوَارِثُونَ, verse number 10 to 11, أَلَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسَ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. If you're fulfilling all of these conditions, Allah says, you shall gain access to Firdaus forever. So Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the term Firdaus in Surah Al-Mu'minun. And in Surah Al-Kahf, and the very last verses, Allah says, those who believe and do good deeds, they shall have Jannatul Firdaus as an abode to live. So these are the two times that the term Firdaus is used in the Quran. And as I said, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he explained to us that Firdaus is the highest level of Jannah, that it is the highest maqam, and we're going to talk about the levels of Jannah in a later lecture. So, one of the terms of Jannah, or one of the terms that is used for the highest level of Jannah, is the term Firdaus, and the equivalent of Firdaus is paradise in the English language. Another term that is used to describe Jannah is Jannatin Na'im. Jannatin Na'im. This is used once in the Quran. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ نَعِيمٌ. Those who believe and do good deeds, they shall have Jannatun Na'im. What does Na'im mean? Na'im is the plural of ni'mah. And ni'mah is every single blessing and pleasure and enjoyment that is pure. Every single good that you make, that makes you happy, that you enjoy, that you want, that you desire, this is called ni'mah. Every pure blessing and every pure enjoyment is a ni'mah. And na'im is the source and the complete enjoyment. Every ni'mah is na'im. Every blessing, every happiness, everything that you can desire, that is na'im. And Allah calls it jannatin na'im. That jannah will be every ni'mah that you can possibly want. It will be there. And that is why it is called jannatin na'im, because it is the source and it is continual and it is shamil or comprehensive. And that's why it is called na'im. Every single ni'mah will be in Jannah for all of eternity. Every desire you have that is pure, it will be found in jannatin na'im. Of the terms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses in the Quran as well, is the term maqam, maqamin amin. And this is used once in the Quran, Surah Al-Dukhan, verse 15, that Allah says, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي مَقَامٍ أَمِينَ. That the righteous are in maqamin amin. The righteous are in a maqam that is amin. Maqam means place. Maqam means status. Maqam means where you're going to be, your aqama, where you have resided. And amin here, it means peace. It means there shall be no worry, no grief. There is no war in Jannah. There is no hunger in Jannah. There's no poverty in Jannah. There's no grief and worry, as we already explained, right? There is no, as the Prophet ﷺ said, لا تباغض. There's no bughd or hatred. There's nothing that will cause you distress. And so, maqamin amin. And in that regard, it is similar to the Darus Salam. So, maqamin amin and Darus Salam, they have very similar and overlapping meanings. And this term is used once in the Quran, in Surah Al-Dukhan, verse 51. Allah says, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي مَقَامٍ أَمِينٍ. That the righteous are in a maqam that is safe and secure. And so we shall, inshaAllah ta'ala, that's our goal, to be in a place where there is no fear, there is no grief. And that is why we also said that when we enter Jannah, there's no huzn. Because where there is huzn, where there is worry, that's not maqamin amin. If you are worried, if you're scared about anything, then you are not in maqamin amin. So in order for Jannah to be Jannah and to be called maqamin amin, all griefs and worries shall be eliminated from the people of Jannah. And what a great blessing that is, subhanAllah. We cannot even imagine life without worries and grief. We cannot imagine life without stress. And yet Jannah is the place of no stress whatsoever. That's why it is called maqamin amin. Of the terms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses to describe Jannah is darul muttaqin. Darul muttaqin. Darul muttaqin is the abode of the righteous and the pious. And this is mentioned once in the Quran, Surah An-Nahl, verse 30. وَلَنِعْمَ دَارُ الْمُتَّقِينَ. And what a great abode of the righteous and the muttaqin. And subhanAllah, this shows us another characteristic of the people of Jannah. You know, we want to be amongst neighbors who are good. Nobody wants to be next to a person that's going to harm him, a person that's going to cause issues, nuisances, a person that's going to be a bad neighbor. We don't like it at all. Anybody who's experienced this, you know exactly how it just ruins everything for you. And Allah is saying, everybody in Jannah will be a muttaqi. Everybody in Jannah will be righteous and pious. You don't have to worry about any other person doing something to hurt you, to irritate you, to backstab you, to say something. There is no ghibah. There is no namima. Nobody will say a negative word. SubhanAllah, can you imagine that? Nobody will ever hurt your feelings in Jannah. That's why everybody will be of the muttaqeen. And so it is the abode that your taqwa will get you access to it. And then once you're in there, you're surrounded by people of taqwa. So darul muttaqeen, one can say, it has both meanings. Number one, to get there, you have to have taqwa. Number two, once you are there, your whole society will be a society of taqwa. And of course, this makes sense, because how else will it be a dar of aman and a dar of salam? How else will it be a place of abode, of peace and security, unless everybody in it is a person of peace and security? Of the terms that Allah Azza wa Jal uses for the concept of Jannah is the term husna. The term husna. And this is mentioned at least once in the Quran, Surah Yunus, verse 26. Allah says in the Quran, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا الْحُسْنَى وَزِيَادَ. Those who do good shall have al-husna, and they shall have more than al-husna. So, what is al-husna? What does it mean? Al-husna means the excellence. Al-husna means the best of the best. Al-Husna is the superlative in Arabic, right? Which the most bestest, if you like, or the best of the best. That's how Husna translates. So Allah calls Jannah Husna, meaning there is nothing better than Jannah. Nothing. It is Al-Husna. Nothing can compete with Al-Husna. Anything you want, you will find it in its best manifestation and its most perfect existence in Jannah. So Al-Husna is the realm of perfection. That's what Al-Husna translates as. Al-Husna is the abode of excellence. Anything that is worthy of existence and is pure, it will be found in perfect existence in Al-Husna. And that's why Allah calls it Al-Husna. And the final term that we'll do, and I want to just point out that obviously in terms of adjectives, one could find more adjectives as well. I tried to use that which is nouns. And again, there's a bit of a gray area that is every single adjective can be converted into a noun as well. So again, one could find other terms that the Quran uses. This is not an exhaustive list of terms, but I tried my best to be at least in terms of nouns, in terms of proper descriptions, let us say. And again, there is a gray area, give and take. One could add some more terms. Of the terms that Allah Azza wa Jal uses, and this shall be our final term for today, is مَقْعَدِ صِدْقٍ مَقْعَدِ صِدْقٍ. And it is used once in the Quran, in Surah Al-Qamar, verses 54 to 55. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَنَهَرٍ, that the righteous shall be in Jannat and in Nahar, gardens, in Jannat and in gardens and in rivers. فِي مَقْعَدِ صِدْقٍ, they shall be in the place of صِدْق, here means truth and honesty, in the place of piety and truthfulness or sincerity. All of these means صدق here. مقعد is a place of rest. So قعد is to sit down. مقعد, where you rest. So Jannah is the place of rest of صدق. How and why is Jannah called مقعد صدق? Our scholars have said a number of things can be said. First and foremost, it is مقعد صدق in that Allah described it and it proved to be true. So it is the abode of truth in that whatever Allah said about it is true. مقعد صدق. Whatever the Prophet ﷺ said about it is true. And so it is the abode of truth being verified, because all of the descriptions of Jannah in the Quran and Sunnah will be seen by us to be true. So it is مقعد صدق. Another reason why it is called مقعد صدق is that only the people who believed in the truth of that مقعد will get to see that مقعد. In other words, it is a manifestation of our belief in the truth, right? We believed in it, and so we will see it. We believed in it. We had صدق in Allah. صدق الله وصدق رسوله. We affirm the truth, the veracity of what Allah and His Messenger said. Because we affirmed it, so we shall then see it. And when we see it, it will be verified. It is authenticated. And so it is called مقعد صدق. It has been authenticated and verified. Everything that we were promised is there. That's the second meaning, secondary meaning of مقعد صدق. And then another meaning that can also be derived is that مقعد صدق, it is called مقعد صدق because the only people that will get there will be the people of صدق, the صديقين, the people who were صادق, the people who said لا إله إلا الله صدقا من قلبه, the people who acted with truth and honesty and who spoke the truth and honesty and who avoided falsehoods and evils. So the people of صدق, the people of righteousness and piety, they will be the ones who will get to enter that place of Jannah, and that is why it is called مقعد صدق, because only the people of صدق will get to be in the مقعد صدق. So there are three, then one can say, why is Jannah called مقعد صدق? Number one, because whatever Allah said about it is true, so it is مقعد صدق. Number two, that only the people who believed in the truth of Allah describing Jannah will get to verify and see it. And then number three, only the people who were صادقين, which means speaking the truth, telling the truth, avoiding falsehoods and lies, living the life truthfully and avoiding acting deceitfully and hypocritically, those are the people that will enter that Jannah. So these, dear brothers and sisters, are some of the names or the main names of Jannah in the Quran and in the Sunnah. And inshallah ta'ala, in our next lesson, we will continue by beginning our descriptions of the entrance of the people of Jannah into Jannah, and then we'll move on to the descriptions of Jannah. See you next week. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ya man ajabta du'a.
فانتصر وحملته في فلكك المشحون يا من أحال النار حول خليله روحا وريحانا